Sunday school lesson this morning, it was great, and I told Brother Watts I wished I would have taped it for some of y'all that didn't get to make it, but he said, you know what, I got you hooked up. I think he's got that on a CD back there for us, so if anybody's interested in learning a little bit more about our religious freedoms and the foundation of that, and being reminded of our Christian heritage from the beginning, Brother Watts did a great job of that. And I say being reminded because he made a fool of us pretty quick right at the very beginning, showing how little we knew about our rights. And it's something that it's like everything else. If you don't use it, you lose it. And sometimes we need to be reminded of it to keep that in the forefront of our minds, because there will come a time, and we're already there, that we need to speak up and fight for our religious freedom. It's going to continue to grow, and that need's going to grow. So a few other announcements here. Sister Janine, anything on the Samaritan's Purse? Everything going okay on that? Okay. All right. We've still got a few boxes up here. And those that can just be taken and filled up and brought back. Is that right?
I will be the one taking them to the church.
Okay. So fill those and bring those back. Okay. So if you have any questions on that, see her about those. We are looking at some plans for Thanksgiving and Christmas. Now, we know in our local area there's just been some rising numbers of the COVID that don't really alarm us. That's expected. We're expecting that to happen, so we're still going to try to be smart about things. So we're taking all that into consideration and see how things are going in the local area before we decide what those events are actually going to look like. So hopefully we'll have some further information on you on that next week. So, also want to invite everybody out for our Sunday school classes. That's something that is a very important time that I've learned to be able to impart, something that we don't always take advantage of that we need to. And it's a good time for us to be able to look and have conversation on God's Word. So encourage you all to get out a little earlier for that, and I know you'll be blessed for it if you can make that happen. So any other announcements or anything else this morning? All right, let's go ahead and stand with us and go to the song for us, brother. Y'all can stand again.
Number 246, stand with us.
I'm
put yourself in that position. And one of your worst moments and scariest moments, nobody's allowed to come in there and be with you. And so that's a, in my opinion, that's another freedom taken away from us that should not be allowed. So
I don't know this lady. Some way or another, she has reached out to me, and I found her on the website, or she found me, and she's been asking for prayers, and I don't even know the lady.
And that's the sister? Okay.
Sherilyn Spencer.
Okay. All right. Well, we don't want to take that for granted. Anytime the world out there calls in a specific way on the church to pray for somebody, I think that's a request that we should honor. And I tell you what, I just want to have a special prayer right now just for her and all those other ones that's in that situation. If y'all would just pray with me. Lord, we don't want to take for granted that when the world out there calls upon us as your people, Lord, to petition for prayer, Lord, that what an honor that is, that they can look to us and know, Lord, that we have a line with you, that we can call upon you, and our faith shows that, Lord, that we can put our faith in you and that you can change things. And I pray that you do that just for this family. Would you please, Lord, and bring glory to your name through this situation? We know the details, and we don't need to share all the details because you know all the details, Lord, and you know much more detail than we know. But, Lord, I pray that through this situation, this scary moment in their life, that you will just come down and reveal yourself to them in a new way and bring a peace like only you can bring, Lord. We can't change outcomes. We can have desires, Lord, but we know that your plans are much better than our plans. So whatever happens in this situation and so many other situations, Lord, out there right now, dealing with this COVID mess that we're dealing with, Lord, I just pray that your peace be prevalent amongst your people, Lord, so they can look to us, Lord, in their time of anxiety, Lord, and they can see that we're not handling this situation the same way that they are having to handle this situation. And this can bring a testimony. We can be a testimony. Our faith can be a testimony and point them back to you, Lord, in these tough times. And Lord, whether we see the glory from it in these specific situations that we're praying for or not, we know, Lord, that all things work together for good for those that love you. So we can have that hope, Lord, knowing that when we ask for these things, Lord, even if they don't look good right now, they will bring good later because we love you, Lord. We pray that. We desire that this morning. So help us to just let that sink into our hearts a little bit deeper this morning. Thank you, Father. Amen. We had a lot of other prayer requests on here that, to be honest with you, it was taking up all the pages. So every couple weeks I'm having to filter those out. So if you have a continued prayer that you would like the church to continue to remember, I'm not taking it off there on purpose, but I invite you to continue to bring that up and remind us of that. It helps us if we hear you specifically asking for that, not just being a name on paper every week. So, is there anybody got it? Yes, ma'am.
Remember my brother-in-law, Dwayne Furlong. He had back surgery Monday. He still had to have to stand up. He's still in the hospital, having a lot of problems. So.
Okay. So, and thank you for the no brain bleeding anymore, but had the back surgery and trying to recover from that.
And Whitney, some of Whitney's family's been diagnosed with COVID, so remember that.
Okay. All right, remember those prayer requests, please. Dwayne Furlong and Whitney, anybody else?
I do have a praise report.
I like that one. Bring
it. Debbie Morris that I had on the prayer list back earlier.
Yes.
Had breast cancer. She passed on Thursday, and she's in remission.
Amen. Amen. That's great. That is great.
And my grandson and most brother has recovered and bought a house this weekend.
Fully. He recovered quickly then. None of the other family or anything.
No.
Okay. And that's the kind of stuff we need to hear too, because people are, I don't know about y'all, yes, there's some bad cases out there, but 90-some% of the people are recovering so quickly and such mild symptoms. I've had a few drivers that work for us. Three of them, they got it, and they never got anything more than the sniffles. And so let's remember those. We need to continue to remind people in the truck out there, or was that somebody else? That was somebody else there? Okay. All right. Any other prayer requests or praise reports, by all means?
I got a praise report from Connie.
Yeah.
She's still got a lot of pain in her back surgery, but she went to the doctor and her bone cancer is holding. I mean, it ain't moving, ain't spreading, ain't doing nothing.
That's great.
I mean, she's on the mend.
That's great. All right, let's remember her. I know she was going through a lot of pain with that surgery and everything, so. We love her and we continue to be praying for her when you talk to her. Alright, any other prayer needs or any praise reports?
One there in Spain, Sid Johnson. Yeah.
Sid Johnson. Okay. Anything specific or just be praying for that family?
He passed away last Wednesday, so.
Okay.
I just want to praise God for His presence in my life, and for the past 2 months I have been doing better and better because of the doctor's change in my medicine. So I just want to praise God for the changes that have taken place so far, and
amen.
I know that He's going to carry the rest of the way.
Amen. Amen. Well, I like it when our praise reports outweigh our prayer concerns. That's good. That's what I love that. That means we got the right glasses on. Anybody else have anything else before we go to the Lord in prayer over these things? I do have a few things under guidance that I do want y'all to remember in prayer. That's our election coming up. And I think everybody from our Sunday school class this morning, a lot of people is already getting out early and voting. So I definitely want to encourage that as your pastor to vote biblically. And so look at those values. And if you don't know how to vote, then meet me after church. And I'll be glad to tell you how I would vote. And I'll tell you to be able to back that up with Scripture. But also there is some voting guides that was sent to us, that was on our front porch steps this morning, that helps give Christians a little guidance on how to vote biblically. And I appreciate that. That means, I don't want to take that for granted. That means somebody else out there has a heart for making sure that us Christians know how to vote biblically, and that's what we should be doing. So they're back there on Brother Watt's table. I'm sure he didn't mind me sharing that table with that, but pick up one of those, and let's make sure we're voting those. And also be here locally. I'm sure y'all see it everywhere y'all go, but different districts are handling it differently, but our schools are going on a two-week lockdown again just because cases have risen up around here, and mainly it's for the quarantines is the reason that's affecting the numbers. I looked at it and I did a calculation last night. You look at how many kids we have in our school, in our school district, compared to how many active cases we have. It's 0.2%, yet they're shutting the schools down for that. And I don't believe in that. It's not my decision to make, but the ripple effect of that, like we was talking about, is there's a lot of moms out there that are very stressed and high anxiety this morning. I guarantee you, trying to figure out how they're going to do this virtual learning, how they're going to be able to work their jobs and still take care of their kids at home. There's a lot of things that go on back door that we don't think about. When you try to fix one problem, you end up creating 10 more a lot of times. And so let's be praying for those families, because we know Satan's going to try his way into those families and work through that anxiety and that stress within the household and try to destroy marriages through that. So let's remember that. All right, go ahead and ask our ushers if they would come on up this morning. Anybody else have any other prayer requests or praise reports?
bless this offering and gift of the year. Pray that you just lead God and direct us with this. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Bonnie had asked me last Sunday if I knew this song, and I shared with her that I did, that when my wife passed away, late wife, in 2015, my daughter and granddaughter sung this song at her graveside when we went back for the first time. And revival came down in the middle of that cemetery that afternoon, and for those of you who don't know, we have a gospel group, and I said, we've got to sing this song from now on. It's got to be part of what we sing. So, Janine and I want to share with you this morning, Going Home. We get home, the more we want to go home. Oh, my heart gets so heavy, and I'm longing to see all my loved ones and friends that have gone. Every step draws me nearer to the land of my dreams, and now I am
going home.
I'm going.
appreciate everything that he does. So I'm going to go ahead and ask him if he'll come up and share some God's word with us this morning.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I appreciate that.
Yes, sir.
Well, no pressure. Well, again, I'm Lee Watts. This is my wife, Chrissy. For those of you we work in Sunday school, get a chance to know about what we do. And it is to be an evangelist. I serve as the missionary chaplain to the Kentucky State Capitol Building. And what that involves is I teach a Bible study every week of the legislative session. I pass out Bibles. I do personal soul winning. I do a lot of counseling with our legislators. And I try to keep an eye on what they're doing up there. Because God is still interested in what goes on in the halls of government. And we're just a little reminder of that to them. And then I like to communicate with the churches and let them know, hey, this is what's going on, and you need to be involved in this, that, or the other. If you would like to stay up to date, because the newspaper is only going to tell you on the TV what they want you to know and the way they want you to know it. So if you'd like to get, I send a monthly newsletter out, and I will be very happy to send you that for $99.95. I will send you a newsletter for free. I used to say $19.95 to people that are serious.
Yeah.
So I have a jack of price. On my little table in the back, you can put your email, and then every month, once a month at the beginning, I'll send you a letter. And if you don't have email, you can put your regular mailing address, and I'll send you a paper copy. But if you have an email, I'd rather do that to be a better steward of the Lord's money, because stamps are expensive. The Sunday school lesson I taught and a bunch of other things that I teach, I have on the table back there in little different boxes. They're color-coded. There's different lessons in every colored box. And everything's $10 each. And there's two CDs in every box. And the CDs, you can put them in your CD player, and it'll play, and you can listen on the radio. Or if you put that same CD in your computer, there's a video, and you can watch the video and see all the slides. So each one does both. And if you want to put the money in the box, see my wife if you need change. And if you want to make out a check, just make it out to Walmart, because they're going to get it anyway. Just make it out to me. And if you have questions about what's going on in Frankfort, just see me after church, and I'll answer what I can for you. Again, for those of you who haven't voted, don't forget, you can vote tomorrow all the way up to what is traditionally Election Day. So make sure you go and you do that. And I was telling Sunday school, there's some things on the back of your ballot, so don't forget to flip it over, because there's two constitutional amendments. The short answer is I'm against both of them, and you can ask me why after church if you like, but that's the reason there. And then I thought it was some good news about the people had said recovery. I did the numbers and I added up. The recovery rate for COVID-19 in the United States is 99.3%. I want you to think about that, church. 99.3% of people who do catch it have the flu for about a week or two that are fine.
Right.
It does mean it does kill some people. It does kill 0.7% of people. Do you realize that is 1.3% less than the regular flu? This is all about control. It is not about health.
Right.
Okay, now, saw the service today. Take your Bibles, please, and turn over to the book of Matthew, chapter number 6. Now, I'm an old-fashioned Baptist preacher, so I enjoy good amen, praise the Lord, hallelujah, and the more you do it, the more I'll keep an eye on the time, and otherwise I may not, but I like doing things the old way. I like in the old days, remember the old days when I was a kid, back in 1931, you could go to the store with a dollar, and you could come out with like two soda pops, a candy bar, and your dollar. Now we got all those cameras, you can't do that anymore. What we're going to look at here in Matthew chapter 6 is probably one of the most famous passages in the entire Bible. Here the disciples are going to Christ and they're like, hey, teach us to pray. And so he's like, all right, I'm going to give you an example. So this is commonly called the Lord's Prayer. And I understand why it's called that, but just to be honest, it's not the Lord's Prayer at all. If you want to see the Lord's Prayer, we pray several times in Scripture. Go over to the Garden of Gethsemane. You can see what he actually prayed. Here he is giving us an example. You ever notice when you call on somebody to pray? I've been in church since I was a little kid. 9 months before I was born, I've been brought to church. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, revival, prayer meeting, jubilee, missions conference, vacation Bible school. My folks would drive by on a Thursday just to see And you know that person just got a hold of heaven. Heaven picked up the phone and they were listening, and you can feel that. And that's the way that it can be each and every time we pray for each and every person. And that's the way that it should be. Sometimes the pastor will say, bring us before the throne of grace. And so when someone is ushered in who's spiritually attuned, you realize we are in heaven's presence. Amen. And that's what I'm going to focus on this morning. Now, up in the Capitol, again, I know the Capitol. That's my ministry up there, ministering to those people. And there's a lot of people who will come up to do a prayer ministry. And there's a lot of prayer ministries. And I'll think, there's one or two that I think God's in. But the vast majority, I think God's within 50 feet of that stuff. Because when they get up, their prayer is all about the flesh and putting on a show. Oh, Jesus, let me tell you, I'm so grateful. And I'm like, just look at me, look at me, look at me.
Yes.
It's all that right. Stuff is. Now, don't get me wrong. I think people can pray that way and get a hold of heaven.
Right.
But I think a lot of times that's done just for show.
Right.
So, Lord, help us there. Notice the Bible talks about this. Jesus talks about this. We haven't got into our main message yet. But just read in verse number 5 and 6. Jesus says, and when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are. He's like, don't do this. For they love to pray. Now, that seems kind of odd. You think, well, the hypocrites, they say they pray, but they don't. No, it says they love to pray. But notice what it says about these people who love to pray. Standing in the synagogue, you know where that was? That's where everybody could see.
Right.
Oh, that's all the business was done there. And in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet. And when thou hast shut thy door, pray to the Father which is in secret. And the Father which is seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Now we here in Western culture, in America and Western Europe, when we think of the closet, we think, well, that's where you put your coat and your clothes and stuff in the closet. We realize they didn't have that back in the Middle East in basically the year zero, year 20 or 33 here. They don't even have that really a lot now. We're going to go to the Holy Land, and not a lot of houses now have closets. They got these little portable armoires. So when it's talking about go in the closet, shut your doors. Let's talk about the prayer shawl that the Jews would wear. And when they would go to the Western Wall or somewhere to pray, they would take that prayer shawl and they would close it up to close out all the distractions of this world. And that was called being in their closet and shutting the doors. So that's what Christ is talking about here. He's like, you know what? Sometimes when you're going to pray to God, you need to shut out all the distractions of this world. You know when I get the most phone calls during the day? I get phone calls from people all across the state every day. Brother Lee, what about this law? Brother Lee, can you help me with this problem? Brother Lee, who should I vote for? This, that, and the other. And you know when they call? As soon as I sit down and pray. How many times have you been praying, and you're praying, and all of a sudden, you find yourself thinking about the laundry list and the shopping list?
Yeah.
You're like, how did I start thinking I need to make sure to get tied and not something other than tied? I can't think of anything else other than tied. When I'm supposed to be praying.
Right.
Or you can think about, I got to make sure to get the diet coke because they don't like prayer. And is it just waking up on the leaves when does that?
Right.
Or is it maybe somebody else? You know what that is? It's because we've not closed those doors to all these distractions in this world. You know one of the reasons why the tradition of the church has come to have the song service first? You know why? That prepares the heart,
right,
and it prepares the mind for worship. We need to close out all of the things going on in this world. And if anybody's guilty of that, it's the one preaching to you right now. Got about 50, I keep a pad of paper in my car, and I'm all, because my brain's always taking something writing down. There needs to come a time when we're the throne of God in God's presence. If I want to get a hold of God, you know what I got to do? I've got to close the door in my mind to all these different things because I'm getting ready to talk to Almighty God.
Amen.
And so that's the first thing that the Lord says before He does anything right. We want God to look down upon us. In Isaiah chapter 66 and verse number 2, the Bible says, I look even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit and trembleth at my word. Now, first of all, again, this is all by way of introduction. We've not even got to the sermon yet, but I throw this part in for free and I don't want to even charge it. It says in Isaiah that I will look unto him that is poor. It's not talking about people who don't have a lot of money, because the Bible repeatedly talks about how the Lord would deal with people who were just destitute. They had absolutely nothing. What it's talking about is the we realize, you know what, I am needy, then that puts us in the right frame of mind. Because you know what a needy person is? They're usually very polite. I remember one time I had just moved out of state. I got out of Lordsville and I moved out of Kentucky. Lord help me, I moved out of Kentucky. I moved to Tennessee to get work, and I didn't have a credit card at the time, and I didn't happen to have checks. I had an ATM card, but I was running out of gas, and there was no ATM around. But I saw a gas station. I said, "Well, I'll just write him a check." So I go up there, and they had a big sign: "We don't take checks." And I had been on fumes for a long time, and I'm like, "Man, I can." I said, "Where's the next gas station?" We're out in the middle of nowhere. They still have another 30 minutes, and I'm like, "I've got maybe 10 more miles, but I'm not gonna make it." I said, "Can I write you a check?" "No, we don't take checks." And so I have money, just not on me. And so I'm like, "Ugh." So you know what? I had to ask for something. I was very blind. And the Lord blessed the very first God I had. He's like, "I remember that." He said, "I've been there. You remember this, and the words allowed me to be able to pass it on to somebody else."
Yeah.
And you remember that too. But you know what a needy person is? They realize I'm in need, and you have a supply.
Yeah.
You know what? It's good for us to remember to be poor in spirit.
Yeah.
Because you know what we have when we get self-sufficient? You're like, "I don't really need God for anything." I'm okay. Very different attitude. It says, "I will look even unto him that is poor and of a contrite spirit." That word contrite means submissive, apologetic. And that gets us in the attitude, you know what, I do have things that I need to ask forgiveness for.
Right.
You ever notice when you've done something wrong and you're talking to the person that you wronged, that your instinct, your body, you can control the words that come out of your mouth, but it's hard to control your body. And what does your body do? It looks down.
Mm-hmm.
Can't even look them in the eye because you know you're guilty. That's one of the reasons that I think it's a good way that we bow our heads to pray. Can't even look the Lord. What did Isaiah say? It's who we're reading right now. He realized when he was before the Lord's presence, he's like, "I am a man of unclean lips. I live amongst the people of unclean lips. Not even worthy to look upon the Lord." And you know what? The Lord says, "I like that kind of spirit in you." Because you know what? When somebody is very haughty, you know what happens all of a sudden? Their nose goes from here to up here. I've met many people in the Capitol talk to me like this. I've met many of them. I notice this little thing when they go to shake hands. Most people, when they go to shake hands, they shake hands like this. You notice there's some people that ever go shake hands, and they'll have to put their hand out like this.
Yeah.
You know what that is? It's a sign of dominance.
Right.
And then they'll usually cup it above and below. I am in control. You know what? If you are asking for something, where's your hand? It's going like this. That's why when the Jews pray, they will pray like this, palms up. Because they realize, I need you, and I'm asking God for something. I think those of us who have a poor and a contrite spirit,
yeah.
"Lord, I've done you wrong. Lord, may you forgive me." It says also, "It trembleth at my word." The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Trouble is, there's not very much fear of the Lord nowadays. So Christ, being our perfect example in all things, is giving us an example here of how to pray. And I think there's one thing that every person can do better on, it's the prayer life.
Amen.
And that includes the preacher who's talking to you right now.
Amen.
I don't care what condition it's in, it could be better. Let's get serious about this matter of prayer. So if you'd stand, please, if you found your text in Matthew chapter 6, we'll read verses 9 through 13. This is what the perfect, holy, inspired, infallible Word of God says. If anybody has any questions, where does Brother Lee stand on that issue? That should hopefully clear the book. All right. Chapter 9, verse 6 says, "After this manner, therefore, pray ye, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power,
Amen.
And the glory forever. Amen."
Amen.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before the throne of grace this morning, Father. I thank you that you have seen fit to bless us all with another week of life, another day we can be here to enjoy the Lord's day.
Yes.
I invite, Father, your Holy Spirit's presence to be here to anoint this time as you would bless the reading, the preaching, the teaching, the hearing of your word. Father, forgive your unworthy servant where he so often failed you. I ask you, Father, you would bless us now. Help us to be found in your will till the day you come for us, and even so come for Jesus. It is in his name we pray, Father. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. Thank you. And please be seated. when we're entering into God's presence. I mean, that is, you ever talk about when somebody goes to visit the king or queen and you go into their presence? That is the royal court. And we are entering, really, into the royal holy court of heaven when we enter the time of prayer. And that's something that we need to realize, how the respect and the propriety that we should have. So often, we treat God like he's our buddy. It's like, well, you know, this is God here. I remember I was reading a story, it's been several years ago, I believe it was during President Bush's time, Junior, the second one. And there was some, I think it was the girls' college volleyball team, if I'm not mistaken. And they had won the national championship for their school in volleyball. So they were going to get to go to the Oval Office and meet the president. And they showed up and they got sent home without meeting. And you know why? Because most of the girls showed up wearing flip-flops. And the protocol officer went to him and said, you do not meet the leader of the free world wearing shorts and flip-flops. Mm-hmm. Go home and change, or don't come back. We are going to meet Almighty, Holy God. We need to do things with propriety and realize we are in God Almighty, the King of the Universe's presence. Mm-hmm. And if we are going to have God's presence come down, then we're going to have to be close to him by doing that. Now, it's good to memorize the Lord's Prayer. That's one of the things people usually memorize. John 3:16, and then memorize the Lord's Prayer. My wife and my kids memorize the verses that say, thou shalt obey thy mother and thy father. But after that, they memorize John 3:16 and the Lord's Prayer. And it's good to memorize it, and it's often quoted. And I have no problem with quoting the Lord's Prayer. It is Scripture. It is good to memorize. It is good to say. But let's be very careful with that. Notice what it says there in verse number 7. It says, but when ye pray, use not vain repetitions. Right. We as Baptists often give the Catholics a hard time for the rosary. It's a little prayer. You memorize it word for word, and then you say it over and over and over again, vain repetition. And here, the Lord is giving us a sample prayer that we as Baptists will sometimes say, and there is no problem in repeating this prayer. Now, that may seem like a contradiction. Brother Lee, you just said, use not vain repetition. That's correct. Don't forget that first word, vain. That means no point to it, no purpose, no heart to it. Not enough to do. He didn't say, don't use repetition. He said, don't use vain repetition. How many times in your personal prayer life have you got your prayer list and you sit down and the prayer that you prayed today, you know what, was the exact same prayer you prayed yesterday? And the exact same prayer. I've been in some churches where the pastor calls somebody to pray for the offering, and they're like, dear Lord, bless this food, because you know what? Just vain repetition. Yeah. And sometimes they didn't catch themselves.
Right.
Lord, help us for those things. Mm-hmm. Now, don't get me wrong, that doesn't mean you don't repeat your prayers. Just not vain repetition. Sometimes you got things on the prayer list for years, and you bring those up, and it's like the Bible says in James chapter 5, verse number 16, the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous man availeth much. Now, notice also what it says in verse number 9. It says, after this manner, like so this way, after this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven. You realize the very first thing you have to do to be able to get a hold of God, to have him listen to your prayers, is for him to be your Father.
Right.
If God is not your Father, then you know what? He's not obligated to listen to your prayers. I remember when my kids were little, and we'd take them over to the playground, and there'd be all these things going on, and then I'd hear 50 kids at the playground, and I'd hear one yell, "Dad!" And I could tell when it was my kid.
Right.
Something's going wrong, I need to put a whooping on somebody, to get my kid. My wife likes to say, she goes, Mama Bear. Somebody's getting her kid. And that's the way that God the Father is. He's like, you know what, I'm going to listen to my children. Sometimes when people will contact the cabinet, and they'll be like, I want to contact them and tell them to be for this bill or to be against this bill. And you'll talk to the operator who takes the messages for the legislators. And they're like, who would you like to leave this message for? And they're like, leave it for all of them. Tell all of them that Joe Smith said vote no on this, or I'm going to vote no out. Well, your legislator gets it. And they look at it like, Joe Smith, he lives in my area. Got to keep that in mind. He votes or doesn't vote for me. However, somebody in the next county, they're like, I don't represent this guy.
Right.
He doesn't vote for me. I'm not even supposed to represent him. I'm only supposed to represent the people of my county. I throw his away. I'm going to listen to my people.
Right.
God the Father listens to his children. There's a lot of common misbeliefs out there. We talk about some of those during Sunday school class, this idea, the separation of church and state. It's not a law, it's not the Constitution, it's not even a good idea. And yet people will say that thinking it is. And you know what? This other idea is that we're all the children of God. That's not true.
Right.
That's something that the world has been pushing out. Notice what the Jesus himself says in John chapter 8, verse number 44. He says, ye are of your father the devil.
Right.
And the lust of your father will ye do. Jesus himself says, you're just the devil's child. Doesn't he say if you live in Kentucky, you are just the devil's child. He says, you are of your father the devil. You'll notice he doesn't say, they are of their father the devil. You ever notice that? Because they means he's talking about people that are somewhere else. He says, ye. Jesus had something called a spine, which is often missing in politicians today.
Right.
It's this thing called a spine. And he stood them to their face and said, you, yeah, you're the one I'm talking to. You're the child of the devil. You're just waking like your father. And you know what? That's the way that we are born, children of the devil. So you know what? You can accept Jesus Christ as your father, but it's a personal choice, and that's the very first prayer that we ever have to make. To make God our father is to ask him, Lord, will you be my father? In Galatians chapter 3, verse number 26, it says, for ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. So how do I get to have God as my Father? I got that through Christ Jesus and my faith in him. In Galatians chapter 4, verses 3 through 7, it says, even so we, when we were the children, talking about the children of this world, when we were the children, we were in bondage under the elements of the world, but when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons.
Right.
So you know what? I used to be a child of this world. I was lost. I was undone. And then one day, the Lord says, I'll adopt you if you'll accept me.
Right.
See, I don't know how adoption works now. I don't know if the kid actually gets to say the thing. But you know how it works in God's economy? Is that the Lord says, I choose you. But I won't force myself. I want to make sure that you choose me back. It says, and if I choose you, then it says, you have now the adoption of sons. When God walks in, let's say, to the orphanage, that's not your father, but when you walk out with him, you can say, that's my father.
Amen.
The adoption of sons. God has sent forth the spirit of his son to your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore, thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. Now, if you have one of these modern versions of Bibles, then I can be no more a servant but a son, and if a son, then an heir of God through Christ.
Amen.
And the words through Christ are missing in any of those words. When we must pray, first thing we have to do to pray is to make sure that we are a child of the Father. If you're not a child of the Father, you can be just like that. You don't have to wait for invitation time. You can take care of it right now. The Lord might come back before invitation time. If I ever saw a day, I know my whole life preachers have been saying, the Lord come back at any time. But I really mean it. I mean, he'd come back at any time. If you think about that, all of everything is pointing to nowadays. Where is the world's entire focus? The world's focus is on that little city, Jerusalem. All right? The Bible predicted that thousands of years ago. Now, it says there's going to be a global economy. Well, they're pushing for that. There's going to be a one-world government. They're pushing for that. Everything is lined up rightly in times. I believe it will be in our lifetimes sometime. So God hears his children. Now also notice what the Lord it does here. He says, after this manner therefore pray ye, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. It says, you know what? He is in heaven. And so what he's claiming, heaven is God's throne. Jesus here is acknowledging who God is. God is in charge. Heaven is your throne. In Acts chapter 7 verse 49 it says, heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. When we just start acknowledging who God is and just saying, Lord, I acknowledge who you are, what you are, what you've done, you know what? That gets us in the right kind of spirit and the right kind of attitude. You realize he made it all. The word universe, uni means one, verse is a line. And so the word universe is there was one spoken line. And that's how everything came to be. Let there be one spoken line. All of it, everything. our biggest telescope, the Hubble telescope, the farthest thing away you can see is a little star that is 9 billion light years away. So if you were able to travel at the speed of light, it would take you 9 billion years to go as far as we can see something that way. And then you would have to come back here and go another 9 billion years traveling the speed of light every second for all that time to get the other thing. And God just says, let there be. And there was. Probably didn't even snap his fingers. And when he did it, maybe he did it, there was a large bang. I don't know. But it says he spoke it and it existed. And when we realize, I am talking to Almighty God who just spoke and all of these things existed.
Amen.
And you start to realize how small you are. That puts us in the right attitude.
Right.
That needy, contrite spirit. The great God Almighty of all. God has to be your Father. We need to put ourselves in the right mindset, acknowledging who He is, the Creator, the Sustainer, all of that. We also do it in, you know, it need to acknowledge what God is. God is all powerful. And the more you realize, you know what? God is all powerful. There is nothing that God cannot do. And the more that you have confidence in that, the less your fears are going to be in charge of you. Because you realize, my Father's in charge of this all. There's something that's been raging in 2020 this year. It has been fear. I talk to people, they're like, well, I'm just afraid to go out. I'm afraid to go vote in person. I'm afraid to go to the store. Fear, fear, fear. What does the Bible say? The Bible says the Lord has not given us a spirit of fear.
Right.
So if you got that, you know where that came from? It didn't come from God.
That's right.
The Lord has given us a spirit. I mean, the Lord has not given us a spirit of fear. And the more that you realize God is in complete control, you realize that in 2019, God knew exactly what COVID-19 was.
Right.
He knew who would kill, who would not kill, who would affect, who wouldn't affect. He knew what you would be wearing when you came to church today. He didn't determine all of that, but he already knew it. If I go and I watch a security camera, let's say we go over to Walmart, and I go in the back where the security cameras are at, and I get the tape out, and I watch the tape. And then you know what? I watch that tape again. I'm going to know everything that everybody's going to do with that security camera tape. I didn't choose for them, but for me, that's the past.
Right.
And I already saw, I already know what's going to happen. You know what? God's already in the future.
Amen.
And so he's already seen all of this. So he didn't make you do that, but he already knows what you're going to do.
Right.
And that's the problem that a lot of these Calvinist predestination people, they don't understand. God is in the past, he's in the present, he's in the future, because God created time. One day he's going to destroy it.
Amen.
And he's already there, he's already seen how it works out. And so you know what? When we start realizing God is all-powerful, none of this took him by surprise, it's going to increase our faith. You realize God is all present. And you realize God is all present. You know what that's going to do? It's going to increase your boldness.
Amen.
If I go out somewhere and I'm walking down the street with my wife and there's, this great big old biker, he's over there and he's like, hey, look at that ugly woman next to that bald ugly guy. I might just be like, no, I just need to be grateful and move alongside him. But if I had 10, 15 of my big preacher brothers with me, I'd be like, I take great offense. We must straighten this brother out of the hands. Because I'm alone. And that gives you great boldness. That's why the Bible says that the man who has many sons, that he will speak in the gate with his enemy.
Right.
You know why? Me and all my big strapping boys, we're going to have a talk. If you're by yourself, you don't do that. When you realize, when you have faith, you know what? I have spent time with God today. I got in God's presence. And he says, I'm going to go with you all day.
Amen.
You know what that gives you? That gives you great boldness.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm going to go witness to that person. I've never seen it. I'm going to go there and get me trapped. I'm going to just, whatever it is, you will have great boldness. You start realizing what God is, all present. God is all powerful. God is all present. God is all knowing. Nothing has taken him by surprise. God is all providing. We talked about that a little bit more. That poor in spirit. When we start realizing that God gave us every little bitty thing, we'll start being a little bit more appreciative. You know, and if we don't get things, you know what we start to do? We start to complain about it.
Yeah.
We just expect things. I mean, I was reminded of this story one time. I read in the newspaper or online somewhere, and it says there was this rich family. They were very well off, and they had a grown son who still lived at home, had no job, didn't need to, mom and daddy, just gave him everything, and he wanted a Mercedes for Christmas. And so when Christmas came, and they said, well, we didn't get you Mercedes, but we did get you a new BMW. He was so mad, went out, got that BMW, turned it on, and then drive himself into the pond they had there in the property. He's like, that's what I think of your BMW. I don't care if he's 40, I'm beating that kid. And we think, what a spoiled brat of a person. Brand new BMW, but I want to understand this. And if I don't get what I want, well, I'm just been put out. Wonder how many times we like, let's say you give your kid an allowance, give him, let's say, $5 a week. Not for doing any chores, just out of your generosity, give him $5 a week. And then 1 week does it, then it goes by and you don't give him $5. Don't work for anybody. Like, what's wrong with you? Where's my $5? We start realizing, well, God is all provided. I'm a severe aspect. And I've had a few places, there's been a few times, especially when I first caught it, where if I couldn't have got to the hospital fast enough, I was going to pass out, and I was lunched. And we just got there, I mean, I was with 90, literally just trying to get there so they could put up air in my lungs. And when you realize, you know what, God is all provided, you will not take another breath.
Amen.
Unless God says, I will provide for your heart to beat. I will provide for Lord, you are all right. Lord, would you give me a meal of bread? Would you give me a meal of bread? Thank you, Father, for this. Instead of just acting like we're owed it all. Thank you, God, for those things that we expect. He is all providing, puts us in the right attitude. God is all seeing. That, realizing God is all seeing, will bring that contrite spirit. You ever be out somewhere and you know that somebody knows what you've done? I know that happened to me a lot when I was a kid. Like, I'd be out having a good time, and then Mom would come right in, and she'd be holding something, which means she found out the trouble that I was in, and I was like, ooh. And all of a sudden, I went from very jovial to very contrite spirit. Mm-hmm. God is all seeing. The most rotten, dirty thing that you've thought or have done that maybe nobody else in the universe knows or will ever know, God knows right now. Amen. And when we realize that, God is all seeing. That must mean the right spirit.
Right.
And you know what? I'm a firm believer. The Bible says that when you get up into heaven, that the books will be open. Books, plural. It doesn't say book. There's one book that we often talk about, the book of life. And if you've accepted Christ as your Father, but what he did on the cross, your name's written down in the book of life. But it says the books are open. And everybody's going to be judged by what they've done. And I can earn reward or suffer loss based on what I've done. That's not how I got to heaven. But I can get reward or loss. I'm a firm believer. On Judgment Day, when he's reading out, you know, hey, watch, you're guilty of this. You're guilty of that. Shame. Shame. But I believe if you take care of it down here, but Lord, I'm guilty according to your word, and I confess I'm guilty. Would you forgive me, Father, of this? Those things are blotted out of that book. Because you know what? You've been judged, and sentence has been given.
Amen.
Take care of down here, God will judge. God is all seeing. When we realize that, we're going to start to get the same spirit like David had. Said, Lord, reveal unto me those secret sins, those things that I've forgotten about, I didn't even think about. And you know what? We take care of those, we get more clean, we get closer to God.
Amen.
He's all powerful, all present, all knowing, all providing, all seeing. He is creator. Realize God made man's body. I don't care what virus comes out. I mean, there's a lot worse things than coronavirus that will kill you a lot faster and a lot more lethal. They got the Ebola. They got all kinds of stuff. It's just terrible out there, and I don't care for it. And you know what? But when you realize God made man's body, he knows exactly how it works, and he can fix it, and you realize that's going to give you, that's going to increase your faith.
Right.
I remember when I was a little kid, my mother took me home. I was fine. And then one day she dropped a dish or something, and she noticed I didn't even turn or stir or nothing. And so she clapped her hands. I didn't turn, stir, or nothing. And And she realized, my little baby has gone deaf. He could hear a few weeks ago, but now I can't. Takes me to the doctor. I have some kind of thing growing in my brain, and it's pushed on your ear tubes, and that's why I can't hear anymore. And the guy had the worst bedside manner of any doctor ever. He said, take your little baby home and love him, because next month he'll be dead. No hope? I mean, this is 1971. So mom is the daughter of a Baptist preacher. My uncle's a preacher. All her friends are preachers. So you know what my mother did? She called a whole calling people who could get a hold of God. Said, my firstborn son, my little baby. My little baby's son is going to. Here it is. 40 million years later. I can still hear it. I'm still here. You know why? God made me in his body. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man. I don't care who's struggling with what in here. God can if he chooses. Now, sometimes we think, well, I guess I just didn't get a hold of heaven because I prayed for somebody to get better and they didn't.
Yeah.
That's not always so.
Right.
Remember, Romans 8:28 says, if things that according to his purpose.
Right.
My purpose is for my brother to get better. That may not be God's purpose.
Yeah.
And sometimes we don't understand what God is doing, but you know what? You have to say, Lord, if I'm doing what I was supposed to do, then this is according to your purpose, and I praise you for that, even though it's not what I want. I think about my little girl, my little Hayley. She's off in college now. And when she's going to college, my dad gave her his truck. She's always wanted a truck. I don't know why. Do I look like a guy who has a truck? But she'd always wanted a little red truck. And not only did he give her a truck, it was his. And she loves her people. That's what she calls them, people. And she says, it smells like people. And it did. And his cologne is in there, smelled like that. And he went out on his Social Security in retirement, bought himself a clunker truck that he has had to fix. It's barely got it running now. So that he can let my little daughter have a truck for her graduation. I mean, just tears. She was so happy. She takes it down there. 2 months later, I get a call. Dad? You know, they don't call at 10 o'clock and say, Dad, she wrecked a truck. Nothing bad. She's driving down the street, and the back wheel got off, and it just kind of pulled her off, and she hit a fence. The truck actually ran fine, but it was all dented up, something terrible. She didn't even have a scratch on it. So we call the insurance company's like, it's an old truck anyway, it costs more to fix than it's worth. We'll pay you to junk it. And they were going to give us more money than that thing would ever be worth. I'm like, hon, if you drove this, if you sold it tomorrow, it would have been fine yesterday. You wouldn't have gotten nearly this much. The wise thing to do is to take the money. Devastated. Not only has she lost freedom, you know, a vehicle, she's like, it was people. And he's driving a junky truck. Contrary spirit. What she doesn't know is that here about 2 weeks ago we went down to see her. I took the insurance money, I went to the junkyard, and I bought the truck. And then I got a preacher friend who runs a body shop in Campbellsville. I had him fix it up. And he's got a preacher's conference here in 2 weeks. I'm going to go pick it up. And you know what? There's money left over from the insurance. So you know what she's going to get this Christmas? She's going to get the truck back in better shape than it started with. And the extra insurance. When I went down to see her 2 weeks ago, she had learned a lesson. She's not out as much. And you know what's happened? Her grades have gone up. Her attitude is better because she's learned some valuable lessons for this. She thinks there's some things Daddy can't fix. And that's a very important lesson to learn as a college kid. And it's made her more appreciative and more careful and getting better grades. Praise the Lord for all that. If I had gone down there and she's like, Dad, man, that's stick. I mean, when did I run a truck? Would have been wrong. I might have just been like, one last visit, and just went home. But you know what? The Father is doing things behind the scenes.
Amen.
And you're like, I don't understand, Father. This is what I want. But you know what? You've got the right attitude. You've got the right spirit.
Yeah.
And one day, Christmas is coming.
Amen.
I've been working this all along.
Good.
Here you go. You keep your truck back. You've got extra insurance money. All is well.
Amen.
Our Heavenly Father has so much more for us.
Amen.
When we realize that he is all sustained. one who brought us back from a devastation. He is gracious. How many times has God blessed you just being generous? Grace is when you get something good and you didn't deserve. That God is very gracious. And when we start listing all the things that God has given us, you know what? That's going to put us in an attitude of praise, and God is pleased with that. In Lamentations chapter 3, verse number 51, it says, "Mine eye affecteth mine heart." And you know what? When I look around, I'm like, Lord, there was a day, and there was a day in Lewis' life where I was friendless, jobless, homeless, had nothing. Sometimes I walk around our beautiful home. Look, I have a beautiful wife. I've got a big old couch. I've got a TV the size of a Buick. And I look, I'm like, Lord, I got a car. She's got a car. My little girls, I have three cars. I had nothing. I had the clothes on my back and I lived in somebody else's bed. Now I've got three cars. I sit and talk to the congressman yesterday. And when you sit and you start looking at all these things, you're like, thank you, God. My mind has affected my heart. All these things we take for granted, we realize God is very gracious to us. He is merciful. Merciful is when you don't get what you do deserve. Now, I found out there's this thing called a warning that cops can give you. I've heard about it, but I've never seen one. But I actually got one here a few months ago. I got a warning. And I was coming home late. I was down in Hazard preaching. And it was late, and I was driving home, and I had a hamburger in one hand, and my tie hat pulled off, and the thing, and I've been tired and out all day. And the state trooper pulls me over. He's like, "What's going on? Where are you going?" I said, "I'm just a tired preacher trying to get home." He's like, "Got a warning, slow down. Be careful, preacher." Because you can see I'm just wore out trying to eat my meal. That's nice. I deserve the ticket. I was traveling under grace, not under the law. And you know what? How many times did the Lord should have given you something and you didn't get the punishment? We can say, thank you, God. And you know what? We start doing, realizing how gracious He is, it'll put us in the right thing. How merciful He is, how long-suffering He is. I tell you, that's what I suffer with, is long-suffering. I don't like to suffer long. I like everything to be quick, short, and on to the next thing. And nothing does make me suffer at all. But you know what? God is long-suffering. I don't know. If I was God, I was struggling dead a long time ago. And I'm sure the idea crossed His mind a few times. Especially when my mother probably prayed for it a few times. Yeah. Alright? But the Lord is long-suffering, and who can say amen? God is kind. We don't have time to get into each of these. Each of these is about 5 minutes, but I'm going to skip ahead for the sake of time. He is kind. He is faithful. When we are not faithful, I wonder how many times we make promises to God, and we don't keep them. You know what? God is faithful. Amen. In Isaiah chapter 49, verse 7, it says, "The Lord that is faithful, and the Holy One of Israel, He shall choose thee." 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9 says, "God is faithful, by whom ye are called into the fellowship of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord." 1 John 9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. You ever know somebody who's just, that's a person I can depend on. I don't care what's going on, what's happening, I can go years from now, I go up to their door, and I know I can depend on exactly them. That is a very rare thing. Very few people like that. God is faithful. And we need to appreciate and acknowledge what He is. God is just. Many people think, God, He doesn't care, I'm just get away with stuff. God is just, which means He's going to be judged one day. Nobody's getting away with squat. And the Lord is going to sort all of this out. And I'm personally looking forward to that day. But the trouble is, I'm looking forward to that day for some other people. I'm not looking forward to it. I dread the judgment seat. You know what? The more that we think about that, how God is judge, and He is just, He's going to make us take care of things, put us in the right attitude. In Revelation chapter 11, verse number 18, we're at the end. "And the time of the dead that they should be judged, and that thou shouldest give reward unto thy servants." I tell you what, that's something that if we get things taken care of down here, we can look forward to the judgment seat. All that time, service and devotion, every time that I was slandered, every time that somebody cursed me for passing the track. God says, do what I wanted, well done. The hero, well done, thou good and faithful servant. That'll make it all worth it. We need to start acknowledging who God is, what God is, thankful for how he is. And when we do all those things, then we're following the Lord. You notice the Lord did all of these things before he asked for bread, before he asked for any of his petitions. These we do first. I don't know the condition of your heart today. Maybe somebody here today who says, you know what, Brother Lee, you talked about knowing God personally as your Father. And I've never asked him to be my Father personally. I just kind of, I go to church and you just think you go to heaven. It's not the way it works. It is a personal choice. Sometimes God has already chosen us, but I have to choose him and say, yes, yes, will you be my Father? He's already said he would. If you're here today and you've never asked God Almighty, saying, will you be my Father through Jesus Christ and his blood? You can do that today. If you're here today and you're like, Brother Lee, my prayer life is nowhere near what it's supposed to be. The Lord, you would correct my heart on that. That's why I have invitation time. It's not Brother Lee's invitation. I've done my job. Invitation time is for you.
Right.
That's where God says, I presented you my word of my day from my book.